not familiar with her, so I'm going to read a brief synopsis of her bio. So these are just a few of the, authentic, inspiring, transformative, and renaissance are just a few of the experiences you will have in Kim's presence. Whether it's sitting with her one-on-one as she listens to you share your truths, or in the audience of a concert, speaking event, and she's done a TED Talk too, you feel the same captivating presence with Kim. Kim has spent the last 20 years writing music and giving inspirational talks and workshops. So let's skip that. Kim is passionate about sharing her story globally to bring more awareness and advocacy to her help eradicate human trafficking, working with spiritual communities, hospitals, counseling centers, first responders, and at-risk youth. Kim brings a unique, compassionate, and empowering approach to creating a space for others to have self-discovery, healing, finding their voice, authentic expression, and purpose. Kim also, I think I just heard, correct me if I'm wrong, has been announced as one of the ministers at New Thought Unity, and spiritual part-time spiritual leader at New Thought Unity in Cincinnati. So if you're there visiting Cincinnati, check out their website to see if she's speaking. Here you go, Kim. It's your turn now. Thank you.
I always feel a little awkward listening to someone read my bio, so thank you for doing that. It was a little uncomfortable. But we're going to start with a song. Sally's going to play with me.
To make you feel my love.
to make you feel my love. Thank you, Sally. So thank you, Sally, for playing, filling in for Michael and Ed, who are here, and get to just be in the audience. Just back from Paris, right? So thank you so much for having me. I like to sing that song, even though it's a love song. I sing it as a love song from Spirit to us. There's nothing I wouldn't do to make you feel and remember the love presence. It's always here. Easy to forget. Easy to look around and see all the reasons why it's not there, right? And so I always like to start with that knowing that that presence is always there. Am I supposed to quit already? They're calling. So my talk title is When the Shift Hits the Fan. The shift has been hitting the fan, hasn't it?
Yeah, sure.
A lot of shift hitting the fan in the world, in our lives, in our communities, probably in your city. There's a lot of shifts, types of shifts, and I want to talk about those. Because how I handle shift and how we handle shift is the most important piece of it. It's not the shift itself. It's how we react to it. Who here likes change? Oh, wow, there's a few people. How about within this community, you like change? Yeah, two people. Oh, wait, a bunch of people now. Yeah, we want change. Let me tell you about these shifts that happen. And even though there are people, I like change too, and I don't respond well to it at the same time. So I want to talk about that, because there's a couple types of shifts. There's the kind where you're praying and you're asking and you're calling something in, and it shows up in your life finally. And what do you feel? Yell out some things. I like audience participation. What do you feel when that thing finally shows up that you've been praying for? What are some things that you feel? What's that?
Gratitude.
Excitement.
Relief.
Anxiety. Overwhelmed.
Humility.
Redemption. All right. Anybody sometimes feel afraid?
Yep.
Unsure. Mm-hmm. Yes, I hear from the back. You're unsure. You wanted it, but you're still not sure because you know what was. But now I've called this thing in and here it is and I don't know what to do with it. And Brené Brown says this. I have a slide. You can choose courage or you can choose comfort, but you can't choose both. Oh, dang. I'd like to be comfortable and courageous. Yet those are opposite things. And so it takes a lot of courage when you call something in and it shows up to actually step into it. That's a big piece of a shift. How many times have things shown up in your life that you called in and you just let them go on by because you were afraid? Am I the only one who's done that? And so there's that. And then there's the metamorphosis process that we go through over and over again. And everybody knows about this process, right? The caterpillar makes itself a cocoon and it goes into the cocoon. But what happens next? It doesn't become the butterfly yet. There's something that has to happen. It dissolves into nothingness. Not knowing, it has to have faith. Your affirmation was about faith, right? It has to have faith that it will emerge again. That's a shift. Going into the cocoon is a shift. It is saying, I'm calling this in and I know that I'm ready for transformation. So I'm going to go in and I'm going to have faith as I go into the nothingness. That takes courage. But there's also another piece. What happens if you cut that cocoon before it's time? It might die, but even if it doesn't die and it emerges alive, it'll never fly. So it will die eventually. So oftentimes we try to cut our processes short, right? We want to get around the uncomfortable. We want to get around the nothingness. And so we'll cut that cocoon short and then wonder why those things aren't taking off. Because it's so important for me to go through the process so that I can fully emerge in that shift and have the transformation and really soar. And so I have another slide there, something about metamorphosis. I don't remember what it says. Oh, there it is. You've got to let go of who you were to become who you will be. You've got to let go of who you were to become who you will be. That's really hard for me because I get real melancholy about old versions of myself, while I'm also dreaming of the version of myself I want to be. And I can get stuck there sometimes and get real complacent and spend years in that space. And so I've been inviting myself to not stay stuck so long in those in-between places. And a lot of times there are the shifts that happen that are out of our control. Pandemic. Unless one of you started that, it's out of our control. Maybe a relationship ends. Maybe someone dies. There are a lot of things that happen. And in our country, we're seeing a lot of shifts and changes happen. And what happens during those changes is fear can rise up. And underneath that fear, it can look like it's an us against them situation in that shift. So how do we stay and choose love? And I'm going to get ready to do this video, so I'm preparing the sound team for the video. So how do we stay in love? Even if it's something that might be hurting us, oppressing me as a human, does it help for me to live from a place of fear? Does it help for me to believe it's us against them? Or does it help for me to just show up as love? I don't have to love what's happening. I don't have to love the oppression. But if I become the oppression, am I helping create the shift that I want to see in the world? Who wants to see more peace for everybody? What's the one way we know how to have peace for everybody? Be the peace. So when there's divisiveness, when we're feeling this fear, showing up with love is so important. And for me, it's really hard to do. So that's why I'm going to show you this video. It's an insurance commercial from Japan. So just at the end, you're going to see the little insurance thing. But the video is about how one person shows up with love, even though everyone around him is sort of shaking their heads like, why are you doing that? And watch how it impacts all the people around him.
เขาจะได้อะไรถ้าเขาทำแบบนี้ทุกวัน